these intercepts, looking forward, not only are they a way to provide emergency medical care to people who need it, but it's also for staff that we already have on duty, it also presents itself as a way to generate more revenue and offset that cost. So the fee for an intercept is $275. So when you do the math, that basically covers that crew, like a crew and a half, for 8 hours. So being able to incorporate that is nice. Ultimately, every single intercept that we're requested on, our policy is that we don't go on it, like I said, unless certain circumstances are met. It's up to the discretion of the lead paramedic provider on duty at that time. So in the interest of public safety and security, if there is an 8-year-old kid having an anaphylactic reaction coming down out of Conway and they're going to pass our fire department, of course, in the interest of saving a life, we would agree to intercept that and things like that. So ultimately, it's up to the discretion of the lead provider, but within the policies that exist on that.
Jack? On the intercept, is the agreement to pay, you know, like, so when we go out on a call, it depends on whoever we pick up on an intercept. Is that the responsibility of the town that calls us, or is that still the patient?
Correct. So it's on the responsibility of the town that calls us. So if Community X calls us, they have a BLS level ambulance, they call us for our paramedic services.
Yep.
They still bill the patient in a traditional way. We give them a bill for whatever we agree on, which is typically $275.
Okay.
So we just get a check for $275 irrespective of what services we performed, and then they bill the patient for everything, including the services we performed.
All right, so we're just talking to the town, we're not talking to the insurance company.
Correct.
Okay,
correct.
Thank you, Zach.
I just want to comment back when Zach was talking about hiring somebody. It's already been established that our step one EMS and step one is not competitive. So the personnel committee was unable to meet this month because they didn't, people were sick, so they didn't have a quorum. So I'm gonna try to get on their agenda next month so that poor Zach, when he goes to hire somebody, we can start at grade three, step three or four or whatever. I mean, our pay rates are, you know, from the 2009 when they were done, and you know, every EMS paramedic that we're hiring, we have to get an exemption from the personnel committee. So we'll try to get that streamlined so that it is much faster for Zach to get people hired, because I'm really concerned that we're burning out our staff, and at some point I just wanted to bring that up at
thank you. That actually kind of segues into the next topic. The short of the long of it is we use a scheduling program right now that's built into our patient care record. And it was nice because it was all together, but that scheduling component was brand new for this company as a way to try to kind of branch out. And it's just proving to be a source of consternation for us. It's not doing what we needed to do. It's still too new. We've given them a couple of years to kind of catch up, and they haven't been there yet. So Gary Ponce, one of our full-time paramedics, actually went out to the EMS Expo in Las Vegas. And while he was out there, he was tasked with researching crew scheduling software specifically. And he came back with a little report. We're scheduling demonstrations for them, and it's kind of all-inclusive. So not only will it solve our problem that we have specifically with our scheduling software right now, which is people not being notified when they sign up or sign-ups getting lost, but it will also do duties such as time clock, punch-in, punch-out. It'll track vacation sick time for the individuals, and it'll also track their certification. So if their CPR card is becoming expired, it'll actually alert them and even lock them out from signing up the shift. So kind of engineering a solution for this. Beyond that, one of the major hurdles that we've had With the size of department we have, it's just doing payroll. And it's overwhelming for us, considering that we just have bare-bones staff, and it's overwhelming for the clerk's office in the town of Deerfield, since now they have this huge department to take on. So this new software that we're looking for will be able to export reports, and I'll be working with the clerk's office of the town of Deerfield to see if there's some way that we can also streamline that. We have a very small window Monday morning to get our timesheets in, and what happens is we submit a timesheet, and the clerk's staff, God bless them, figure out something is calculated wrong or something doesn't make sense, and then we have to track down the employee, and sometimes that's just a result of how cumbersome our system is. So by going to this new system, that'll all be streamlined. And
how many employees are there total?
There are 8 full-time employees, plus myself, so 9 full-time employees, yep. And 32 part-time staff.
And everybody's responsible for their own time card?
Right now, yes, absolutely. So they have to submit their time cards. They attest to its accuracy, and then it's reviewed by either myself or somebody else doing administrative duties to just make sure everything looks okay. So it actually has 2 signatures on it. Then it gets submitted to the clerk's office. But between shift differentials, overtime, holiday, all these things, especially for our per diems that may only work a handful of shifts a month, or even forget to submit a time card, it's just too cumbersome. So these new programs will be able to generate reports for us automatically and be able to save a lot of the time that is wasted now with our staff doing administrative stuff and trying to track these people down and generate their own reports.
Would the new system be connected to, for lack of a better term, punching in and punching out electronically so that an employee's not going back and saying, I worked Monday from 10 to 5, you know, so
right.
That it's automatic, so there's no, so because people make mistakes, and
yeah.
This eliminates those. Would
so
you do that?
I've worked in systems with things like this, and typically what happens is you would come into a shift and you would punch in,
yeah.
And it's only a designated computer, so you can't do it from home.
Right.
And then you punch out. At the end of the pay period, you would then, as the employee, have to log in and attest to its accuracy, and that's when you can make a note, and you can say, I was 15 minutes late here, I should have punched in early, and that gives an opportunity for the manager or the supervisor to double-check that stuff. And once the employee says, this is accurate, it gets forwarded, checked off by management, and then it's all electronic, it's calculated automatically that way.
So, but if you can't trust the people to fill out a time card accurately, how are you going to trust them to put the proper information into the computer?
Well, right now the problem is our timesheets are done with an Excel spreadsheet, and it's extremely cumbersome, especially with the callbacks that we have and the shift differentials. So, for our full-time staff, it's easy. They do it every single day, every single week, every single pay period. For our part-time staff, it's not a normal thing for them, and so we spend a lot of time trying to fix and even hunt them down to make sure they get their pay sheets in. So if we go to a system where they punch in at the beginning of the shift and punch out at the end of the shift, all those calculations, all that those things are handled for them automatically. They just punch in and punch out, and that's it. Everything else happens behind the scenes. This we hope will not only make life a lot easier for our staff from the submitting the payroll aspect, but also from the management standpoint, the amount of time that we waste trying to collect this data and forward it off, and also in the clerk's office, the time that they waste trying to double check our math and even manually enter into the system, where if we can generate an electronic report that gets imported automatically, it would save them as well. So,
with the one person out and your per diems, are you getting enough coverage from outside?
Yeah, so
using the full timers.
So right now, so here's a big spiel. And we'll talk about overtime because I know that's been a concern. We are minimally staffed agency. You need 2 people 24/7. In order to staff an ambulance. We're actually understaffed for that. We cover all but 1 8-hour shift a week. So right out of the gate, if nobody's ever sick, nobody needs any in-service training, nobody ever takes any vacation, I have 16 hours a week of coverage that I need. When you factor in all these on averages, these vacations, these sick days, the 200 hours every 2 years of in-service training our staff require, I'm actually, on average, 60 hours behind the 8 ball every week. And with this full-time employee, I'm an additional 40 hours behind. So for the past few months, every week, I need to find 100 hours of our per diems to cover. The short answer is, we've been doing that. The long answer is, in order to keep a truck staffed 24/7, with 2 days' notice, sometimes we have to find somebody and our full-time staff step up for overtime. We're unique in that, as a paramedic level service, in order to keep it at the paramedic level, which we're required to do per regulation, we need to find a paramedic. And paramedics are professionals. They've gone to school for 3 years and they have full-time jobs elsewhere. So unlike other agencies where you can find somebody just looking to get into the business who's eager to pick up all those shifts, I need to find people who are professional in the career already. It would be similar to trying to find a sergeant on a police department to backfill another sergeant.
You said that you had a couple of applicants that might fill that?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So so going forward, like, that's going to solve a lot of it. I've got, as I said before, 32 people on our per diem list, and we have a cadre, a very strong cadre of people that are picking up a lot of shifts. When it comes down to it, too, the main concerns are obviously employee burnout and the fiscal stuff, right? So are we blowing our budget up? So employee burnout, totally on our minds, and the staff knows that this is one of the most important things to me, and I told them, I said, nope, too many hours, I don't care how many, you know, how much you say you feel okay, you're not working again. We have policies about the amount of hours they're allowed to work consecutively and things like that. And also, the staff know that even if they sign up for shifts, if they're burnt out, they can throw in the towel. This past Sunday, I worked 15 and a half, 16 hours, uncompensated on my part because I'm salaried, but to cover an employee who had signed up for overtime and the night before said, you know what, I had a rough day today, I can't do it. And I said, no problem, your health is important, I want you to come back refreshed, I'll come in and do it. So that's definitely the forefront and something we're watching. On the fiscal side, the short answer, if there's ever been one out of my mouth, is we're still under budget for our personnel expenses, what we're budgeted for to this point at the year. We're not over what we've expected to spend on personnel up to this point, as an indication of what we were expecting overtime would be and things like that. Additionally, our options are, if say a paramedic calls out, I can either not fill that slot, which would be a violation of regulation, right? Or I could go down to the basic level and find an EMT basic who lives in the community who could fill that slot. The problem with doing that is our ambulance then drops from a paramedic level down to a basic level. And our response time of 7 minutes for ALS now goes back up to 20-something because we're relying for an intercept to come from another community. And, as I said before, that intercept cost me $275. 8 hours of overtime for a paramedic cost me $250. And that doesn't include the EMT that I was filling in. So we're actually, as long as we're making sure that we're watching burnout and morale, which I think we're doing a pretty good job about that, it actually fiscally makes more sense just to keep paying the overtime than be calling for the intercepts.
Why not hire two people?
I was just going to say, if you have multiple candidates, you have two candidates are paramedics.
Yeah.
I would be my suggestion that we actually hire the paramedics then, because you know, this last pay period it was almost $7,200 in overtime.
Mm-hmm.
And we actually, if you run the numbers, we're about 33% salary spent and we're only 27.8% of the year gone by. Mm-hmm. So if you project that out at the same rate, you're actually, you know, we have a real chance of, you know, getting 15 or 20% over budget.
Presuming we never fill that full-time slot
Right. And I understand that. So in my mind, we would be better off taking the risk of hiring a paramedic, an extra paramedic, mm-hmm. so that we can get our overtime under control and have the paramedic level service. Because if you look at our run history and intercepts and all that kind of stuff, we would still be better off. And we have, you know, we are going to cover our costs. So it's not, to me, it's not really a risk anymore. And I worry about, you know, staff burnout and that kind of stuff. And And so if we can get these people on board relatively quick, it's great, but I also, you know, we could reach out to the community. I mean, it behoove us to reach out to the community and make sure that we are, you know, having people volunteer as per diem. Mm-hmm. So you can, so we don't risk anybody. I'm just worried about the staff burnout. Mm-hmm. And and I mean, financially, it just makes sense to hire an extra person. I mean, I don't know how everyone else feels, but if you run the numbers, we can have the second person.
I had asked a question before, but how about hiring a clerical worker? So you're not paying a trained paramedic or EMT mm-hmm. to do the scheduling and to do the payroll.
Sure.
There seems to be a fair amount of errors. I don't know that. I'm just going from what you said. If you had somebody, it might take a few weeks to get them on board, but once if they're doing that all the time, even if it was a part-time, they could come in at whatever days you need it, and they could go over all of these payrolls, everything, deal with the people in Deerfield, and just smooth
There's certainly a lot of clerical stuff, a lot of admin stuff that obviously I do, and then gets delegated out. You know, the police department's a prime example, same size department ostensibly, and they have a clerical person that handles those things. I don't have any place to put one. I've got eight people sharing, you know, this much space. You know, like physically, if tomorrow I got the green light to hire a clerical person, I don't even have a chair for him someplace. So
I don't mean to interrupt, but do you use that small office in Deerfield very frequently? I mean, is that something you could address to? Give to a clerical worker? I mean, that would be handy right in town hall because they could deal with Brenda. I keep getting those two mixed up. Brenda on the payroll. And,
yeah, I mean, the short answer is in that I would be without an office and I need an office. Okay. So we just,
and
if that segues into housing, then it does. But
we have to get the housing sorted.
Before, if I could, one second, Mr. Chair, could
go ahead.
Before we decide to hire an additional person, could we, Zach, could you have a study done on what the costs are, the full costs of an additional person, what that would save you, and have a presentation for us, so we can look at that? And I agree, just looking at topically, it may be right, but if you can put something together for us.
Sure.
But I agree with Kip, I don't know how you fit the paramedic / clerical, you know, I don't necessarily want a highly trained paramedic doing clerical work necessarily, but at the same time, I think we have to find that balance.
Yeah, right, absolutely.
So if you could, you know, just show us what costs are,
and
we'll see if we can fit, but it may be justified, but or maybe we have to hire a part-time person. I don't know if those are available either. And the other thing is, is how do you get the person, not to hire that person to a shift, but to hire them to a multi-shift potential, you know, day shift, night shift, weekends, you know, and I know in the power plant industry they do that, but how would you guys work that so that you have that floater?
Right.
Thank
you.
Was there anything else left on your report?
Truck has been ordered. Build number has been assigned, and we're thinking late February, mid-March for delivery on that.
Is it going to be yellow?
Like banana yellow green, maybe?
Green when it's cold, when it goes out in the sun, right?
You know the mood of the paramedics inside? Yeah.
Instead of a mood stone, it's a mood truck.
Exactly.
Did you ever reach out to the USDA program I spoke about?
No, I don't have their...
I think that we kind of missed the boat on that.
Okay.
I went to a seminar in Northampton a few weeks ago, and there was a gentleman from the state and from the federal government, and the USDA has quite a few programs dealing directly with this, and I think they're the same folks that helped Waitley finance their building. And the guy basically said, I'm begging you folks to come and apply for this. And with this ambulance in particular, being a $280,000 unit, when I followed up on it, because of the size of our town and our medium income, we were, we could have received up to 35% of the cost of that ambulance, would have been $90,000 in the form of a grant. And the rest of it, they would have financed for 1% for, you know, anywhere from 1 year to 10 years.
Well, I mean, it's going to be a regular replacement item, so we should still follow up on it.
Couple of years down the road.
Yeah, I mean, because those programs change all the time, but they also are renewed on a regular basis. So it potentially would be there on the next replacement.
What was the deadline on that?
There was none. It just keeps going on and on.
Oh, so you're saying we missed the boat?
We just didn't, yeah.
Could we still apply?
Yeah.
I don't know that. I called afterwards and I spoke with people in Hadley about it, and she's the one that told me the 35% because of the size of our communities and stuff. The tie-in to that is that they won't give you the grant money if you're going to pay for it. You have to use their financing as well. But it was 1%, so it was pretty reasonable, yeah.
Maybe.
And there was no prepayment penalty, so.
Maybe we should still look into it.
You could still pay for it.
Yeah. Kip, you said that you had his contact information?
Yep, it's a girl.
Her contact information, okay.
There's two USDA offices, one in Amherst, but the one that deals with this community, rural community development.
The one right off Route 9?
Rural Development, Inc.
But the USDA office is on 116 in South Amherst.
Yep.
But the Hadley office is the one that they transferred me to, and that's what the. The guy's name is Daniel.
Yeah, especially if they're so eager to.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Make the loan. I mean, they may have ways for us to backtrack that we haven't thought about.
Sure.
Worth checking out.
Absolutely. You'd say 35%, absolutely.
Is there anyone in any of the three town governments who'd be able to help with doing the research on that?
I listened to the presentation and I did call, and it sounds as easy as applying for. When I spoke to the woman in Hadley, she didn't make it sound as easy as the gentleman at the thing, but
of course.
He basically, you know, he really did say, I'm begging you folks to apply for these different programs. And it wasn't just for ambulance, it was, you know, it could have been for a facility, it could have been for water or sewer or anything like that. And he says that, you know, sometimes their application process is a bit cumbersome, but if you go into the office, they will walk you through the application and everything.
Doug Finn had explored them, and Kat was actually preparing the original USDA stuff for us, and then we've lost both those people in the town hall. So that's fell through the cracks once.
Yeah.
Brian, since we have history with USDA through our building, I mean, do you want to see what help you might be able to give to Zach? Because you've at least dealt with these people.
Yeah.
$90,000 is a nice kick in it.
Well, yeah, I was just going to say, just to find out, we already voted the purchase and the paperwork has already gone through and the order has gone through, but if we can backtrack it a little, we could find out if we could backtrack it. Otherwise, just get the contact person's name and we'll get ready for our next purchase.
Okay.
So they'll figure out a way to backtrack it if they want. I mean, they've got to show their value add as well to authorization people and appropriation people.
You know,
haven't paid for it, right?
Yeah,
we haven't paid for it.
No, the check hasn't been issued.
Mm-hmm. It's sort of like a refi.
Yeah.
Without fine.
Well, we'll check it out. It's worth the opportunity for sure. Thank you very much. That's very nice.
Can we have a motion to approve some minutes, if you could list all those off that I plugged up everybody's emails with?
Mr. Chair, if I could make one addition to the minutes, can we attach all the director reports to those minutes as well?
I bet the director could.
And I just think, I think his director's reports gives us, it's a nice history of what's happening with the program, so. If we could, I would recommend that we attach the appropriate director's report with the minutes.
Yep.
It'd be nice if we could have the minutes posted.
We'll put them on the webpage once they're getting approved, please.
We're a little behind.
Sorry.
We just got caught up.
So I've got a list of, make a motion to approve minutes for May 2016, March 2016, June 2016, July 2016, August 2016, September 2016, and October 2016.
I second that.
Let's make sure which of those can this group approve and which of those only certain people.
No, you can approve them all. They change the law.
They did?
Everybody can.
Even if we weren't there?
Yeah. The sitting board can.
I'm not sure that was a good lot of change, but okay.
When they did the record law, that was one of the things, I guess.
Yeah, I agree with you. Oh, right.
Okay.
Let me retry.
Well, you'd have to get that October.
You'd have to take back the October because that's today.
It is kind of strange.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Yeah. I couldn't take a nap, but it just didn't change.
Well, I guess if there is a board changes and they have, you know.
Oh, you're right, sorry.
Board changes.
It's the agenda.
Well, no, your agenda, not the minutes.
Yes, but there's no way people say.
I second the motion without the October.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank God.
Thank you for doing that.
Yeah.
That was a lot.
That was a lot of work.
Thank Wendy.
So how do we want the min, who's, we're going to have to set somebody as the, Brian, is it called the ROA, record person in charge?
Oh, records access officer, I think.
Yeah, how does that work? And do we have a lead community with the minutes?
Wendy's got them all together in her office.
And we'll post them on our webpage. And so I'm assuming that would be part of our fiscal responsibility, Barbara, once we have not generated a policy. We did appoint Barbara Hancock, our town clerk. It's not the person, it's the position. So the town clerk is our access record person. And then we also appointed the police clerk, police-related access. And it's Barbara and Debbie, so. And then we'll take these minutes, post them on our website, and I'll have Pat post them. And there they are for the public.
I'd recommend that they get posted on all three websites.
Okay.
Sure.
So then I guess, Zach, could you forward them to Sunderland and Whately?
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Kip, any updates you want to share with us about possible housing?
Things haven't changed a whole lot, but what we did is we developed a lease, and the entire lease is exactly the lease that you currently have with the South Deerfield Fire District, except for the first two pages, and it basically has the town of Deerfield as a landlord. And the same thing, same address, same place. The rent would be $36,000 a year, and it's a three-year lease that can be extended, you know, three, four, five times, however many, you know, you want to go. And I guess I can pretty much leave it at that.
I just want to add that we're having a special town meeting November 14th. It's on the warrant to have the property restriction lifted on the property next to the fire station so that it can have an EMS building. And we're hoping to have information on Halloween weekend. Is trustee weekend at Deerfield Academy. So we'll have information on either this a dollar amount of a gift or the actual building of a gift. And we're hoping that the town will support the town's commitment to build the building. And so we should have an okay at town meeting on the 14th, one way or the other. However, so that's why the lease is being presented that way, is we're making a commitment to provide the building. We've had discussions, Kip knows that we feel that it's important to have at least a 4-bay building, potentially 5-bay, and that we need room, additional room.
3 going to 4.
Yeah, well.
Four going to 5.
Well, we had discussions about 4 to 5. I just think it's important that if it's 100% gift, and they're gifting us 4 bays, then we're just gonna take it. But we had talked about if we're gonna build it, and we're talking about a long-term commitment of SCEMS, then to me, it should be, we should be thinking about the 5-bay. But the idea was that we would have additional space in the building as well, because it was to give comparable space, and it's too small, it's already, so. It doesn't make sense to shoehorn people in. And
but I do want to correct you, it's 3-bay going to 4 or 5.
Okay.
The original one
correct.
Was 3-bay.
Yes,
correct.
Yes, the original one was 3. And if they gift us 3, we'll take it and then we'll add on. And we'll make, the town is making a commitment to add on. But if it's a dollar amount and we're building it as a town, then we will build the 4 or 5-bay for sure up front. And we also need to make more space for like an admin person, clerical staff. And you know, we're already talking about more staff, so it has to be bigger, a little bit bigger, if we're gonna go long term, you know, 21 year commitment or whatever. So, but I do feel that the numbers are there, and I'm in support of it, committing the town to do this. And I think we will have town meeting support. It's just going to be very busy that first week in November, because once we find out what the track is, we have to go to the finance committee, we have to go to the capital improvement committee, and we have to have a public hearing as an informational night. So we'll be out a few nights in a row, but I think the community, there's enough information out there already that the community sees that it's a, you know, it's a possible thing.
My question about this facility, the plans that were drafted up, I still don't feel good about as far as layout and things like that. And we're having the discussion about size, that initially this number of 3,500 to 4,000 square feet are like an immediate what we need to comfortably operate now. And when we were talking about
bigger size.
Well, when we were talking about the library building, you know, it was this idea that this is, we need something immediately, we can move in here, it's going to meet all of our needs. Long-term goal, you know, we would reevaluate, see about expanding and things like that. I just want to make sure that if any discussion is occurring about special town meeting and building something or whatever, that there's even a square footage quoted in this lease agreement that, like, I don't know what we're talking about other than 3,680 square feet. I don't know what that means as far as
the plan that you saw before with the offices and the 3-bay garage.
Okay, all right. That feels like I have issues with that from an operational standpoint. So I don't know at what point it's brought before a building committee of the Board of Oversight to decide what's most appropriate for the service or what happens. I just don't want to put the cart before the horse and have somebody stand up and say, you know, is this building what we're talking about, we're voting on, suitable?
Well, it was through my discussions with you, Zach, that it made sense that if we were, if it wasn't a gift, then and it was a monetary amount towards a building, then we would definitely go into the extra number of bays. We talked about clerical support right along, but you know, it just didn't make sense for me to looking at the staffing numbers and, you know, paying overtime for paramedics to do paperwork or, you know, EMTs
right.
to do paperwork. We needed a clerical person,
you
at least part time.
Right.
And so you need to make space for a clerical person. And, you know, that kind of thing. So absolutely, when we find out which route is going, we're going. I would hope that people would have conversations with you on the design, and there will be some kind of subcommittee, at least, that would be interested. Or a building subcommittee that would have input.
Jonathan? You're absorbing a lot. Anybody have any conversations with Whately this month, since last?
Well, I guess my, I, what dollar amount have you gone to the Deerfield County with?
I'm hoping that they will want to do the whole building.
But how much did you ask for? How much did you cite that as?
It wasn't me, it was Kevin.
It's up to them.
But they didn't ask for a dollar amount for construction?
They're going to do it.
Okay, well, they're not necessarily going to do it yet, though.
Right. If the town of Deerfield does it, it would be about $800,000.
Well, I'm under the impression it's upwards of $1 million. Prevailing wage has to be used.
I'm not, Jonathan, I'm not arguing.
Oh, no, because there's no way you do it for $800,000 using prevailing wage. The figure of $800,000 was without prevailing wage.
The thing is, this is, I mean, I don't mind talking about it, but I don't want to waste a lot of time. This is a proposal that the town of Deerfield is putting before this board, and how we get the money and stuff is up to us. It's not necessarily our.
Oh, no, an IMA means that all three towns are signing off on it, and I'm going to follow the law.
It's just the renting thing, but you're just signing off on the renting of the finished product. You're not on building it. You understand, or am I missing something?
No, you're not missing. You're fine, Jim. There have not been any bid-ready documents on either proposal yet. Accurate?
Correct.
So we truly don't know the cost of your proposal. You're ballpark.
I have a real good idea of what we could get.
Sure. And we don't know.
But his, if I could interject for 1 second.
Yeah.
I think what Kip is saying about the money is not a concern, because they're setting a value right now for the rent.
Yes.
Right, no matter what.
No matter what.
No matter what, he set a value for the rent.
Correct. The $36,000 per year.
Right.
Is whether the building ends up coming our way for nothing, or if we spend $900,000 for it. It doesn't matter to the South County EMS. This is a dollar amount that the.
Which is more than the rent of the Whately building.
$36,000 a year?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What were you going to charge for a year?
We were going to charge 20 plus utilities. That we then we've gone over that number at many meetings.
Okay, what were you going to charge for the build-up? Is Whately going to pay for the build-up? Because that's what Deerfield is doing.
No, that would be.
See, that's a huge difference, and that's exactly why we're doing it. Because we're not asking Sunderland or Whately for a penny to do this. Just South County EMS, we're offering this completed building for the service to rent.
So what happens, and I assume if Deerfield Academy did not go along with this, you have town meeting vote, and I assume you go to town meeting with a dollar amount.
We're going to the town meeting with $850,000, and we will get a gift. So if it's more, it's just I don't know the amount of the gift. We're going up to $850,000.
So you know you're going to get a gift.
Yes, I feel very confident. The Deerfield Academy is supporting of us to get.
Even though reports are that they hadn't even heard about it.
Well, Jonathan, I don't know who you've talked to. Kip has been the main person that has had conversations, but I don't.
And what's the timeline?
This building
will be completed, so it can be occupied by the end of June.
Yeah.
so.
July 1st.
July 1st.
But if, you're gonna go to town meeting, and if you get, if, let's say you need $850,000 from the town, from the taxpayers of Deerfield, let's say, just argument sake. You're gonna go to free cash with that?
No, we're gonna bond it.
You're gonna bond it at, when?
It's, we have to go to, we have to go through the process of borrowing the money.
Right, right, but that's a debt exclusion though.
John, and we feel comfortable that the town will support it.
Okay, but Carolyn, by timeline, this is what I'm struggling with. You have town meeting in November. Debt exclusion happens.
We'll go through the process.
February, March-ish, at best. And you're gonna build a building for, ready to be occupied in 4 months? You're gonna build a building in 4 months?
It's a fairly simple building, it's a one-story building. I don't know, I feel comfortable with Kip.
Of course you do, Carolyn.
I'm sorry, I worked with Kip over the summer on the school roof, and I feel comfortable with his estimates.
I won't say anything about the school roof, that went over, that worked out really well.
It was under budget.
It would've been a lot better if we didn't have the school department involved with it.
It was under budget, and it was on time. It was fine, and we have a wonderful product, we have a good product. It was a lot of work to get it done, but it was not anything to do with Kip. He's the one that made it happen. It wouldn't have been done that way.
Mr. Upton?
I don't know if I wanna bring it up or not, but I'm a little hesitant here. I just wanna go back to the bays and that, and we're talking about growth with this, with EMS South County. And right up front, I wanna say the service being provided, done a great job. Response time's down to 7 minutes. That's what was presented to people, to all three towns. The town voted. The focus when it was presented was to provide EMT service for the residents of three towns. And we have accomplished that. Obviously, we need to get this building a home for the service. No question about that. But now we're talking about a fourth bay and a fifth bay and so on and so forth. And I'm starting to get a little unnerved here about why, if we're meeting the needs of the three communities with great response times and with a so-called reasonable budget, which some of us may still have some questions about, but why are now we all of a sudden we're talking about growing, additional bays. If we're talking additional bays, does that mean additional vehicles and so on and so forth? And I'm getting a little nervous about that because, how's that going to impact the budget? Now, if we can continue to do this, and by growing, it's going to reduce our budget for all three towns, then that's something to look at. But I would need some guarantees. As far as the growth, If with the growth going to come an increase in our budget line, our bottom line, that gets me a little nervous because I don't know if you can improve on your 7 minute response times here. Mm-hmm. So, are we taking a good thing and blowing that balloon up a little too big? Are we going to be able to still survive and provide the services that we are here, mm-hmm. and keep the costs reasonable? Or if we grow this by the fourth and fifth bay and so on and so forth, are we also going to grow the budget for the three towns? And I'm a little concerned about that.
Mr. Chair, if I could, please?
Sure.
Jeff, one thing I'd like to say is that the South County EMS Board Committee has only asked for three bays.
Right, yeah, no, I understand.
Okay,
right.
And I want, and maybe Kip needs to talk, and Carolyn or Trevor, the fourth or fifth phase, that's something that Deerfield may choose to do, but it's not the intent of our group right now to have a fourth or fifth bay, I don't think. Correct. We haven't talked about that, so
okay.
I understand your concern.
Right.
Because you're right.
I share it too.
So maybe they can, but just please remember, we just talked about the three bays.
Three bays. That's what I thought where we're headed.
I think.
And I understand Zach's point. You know, people need a little elbow room. There's no question about it. But yeah, I just don't.
Right. If you're going to build something, even if we go to Whately or we go to Deerfield, whichever right. we end up at, we want to make sure that we want to make sure we spend our dollars wisely. No matter what product
right.
we do, we want to spend our dollars wisely, and we don't want to build a place that we're going to outgrow within a day.
Right. Yeah, no, understandable.
Jeff, nobody is saying that we are going to grow to take on Greenfield and Montague full time or anything like that. But the idea is, if you're going to build a building,
mm-hmm.
you build that extra bay in or two,
right.
because you know it's much more expensive later on.
Right. Yeah. No, I understand that. I'm just saying, as long as it's cost effective, that's all.
And you always are running this balance between the number of calls.
Mm-hmm.
Number of intercepts, all that kind of stuff, and it's a constant
right.
thing. And you don't want to shortchange yourself.
Right. Well, you don't want to shortchange the community, the three communities,
no
question about it.
But
you also don't want to shortchange people when it comes to the budget. You've got to maintain that bottom line.
Right.
Jeff, we understand
right.
that. But
okay.
it is really, really important that we get up and running and we find that spot, and it will constantly be back and forth all the time,
right.
and you've got to that's what the purpose
right.
of this oversight committee is.
Right.
To
well, no, I know, and they've been very careful, and they've been working on this for 2-3 years now, trying to keep it so it doesn't get out of hand.
Yeah.
And they've done I think they've done a fairly decent job. With that, but I just don't want it all of a sudden now here we are at this point to start growing again before we really have our hands wrapped around the whole thing, you know? That's all.
But we were just talking about the risk. I think it makes sense to have the extra paramedic
mm-hmm.
on staff and not pay so much overtime,
mm-hmm.
and it is a constant juggling
right.
thing.
Right.
But then also if you have the ambulances, which is what we're having,
mm-hmm.
we will have three really good, pretty good ambulances. It's important
in
that
one
you,
location.
In one location,
right.
it's important to be able to utilize them.
Well, no, I think, and I think everybody agrees with that point. But, you know, that's.
And may not be a vehicle in it, but it might be.
Well,
we
were talking about the intercept vehicle, and the intercept vehicle is important because you have your meds and your other stuff
right.
running, and you're not running your big
right.
270,000.
As long as it's cost effective.
Right,
yeah.
and then
right.
that. Fits into a bay, you know, so I'm just saying that is cost effective. We've already talked, that has been talked about, and it makes sense, and the dollars make an amount, but why do you want it outside? You know, it should be
undercover. I understand, as long as
right.
we don't increase that bottom line.
I think that all
it's
of us are
it's
gonna
pay
aware,
for itself.
Yes, and I think all of us are aware we want the assessments to go down ultimately, and I think they will. And I mean, this has a good track record, and we were all comfortable that, you know, combining, we would produce a track record, and it's panning out. It's just that we have to keep adjusting.
So just to be clear, the fourth and fifth bay are concepts of the town of Deerfield right now?
Yes, it's because if we're going to actually build something, and we're supposed to finance
sure.
it, I don't want to have to go back. In five or six years and have to add on.
Well,
you know, we're going to add on already. I mean, we're talking about an intercept vehicle already. So
right, and we need to be very careful because we're limited in terms of how long we can sign an IMA for, by the way, as a reminder.
I know, but that's why we...
And I've been reminded of that by the town of Deerfield many times, that, well, we don't know what we're going to do, you know, around in 3 years.
I know.
Mr. Chair, that's why we kind of, you know, drafted the way the fire department did. It's 3 years at a time. And if we agree, then we can go for another 3 years if we just keep going like that.
And you really don't mind being on the hook for the additional money if there's all of a sudden no South County EMS?
No.
The taxpayers of Deerfield really don't mind that?
Well, we'll ask them.
I mean, they have to vote, obviously, John. But I think it makes sense from a dollar point of view.
I mean,
it's $3,700 a month.
For who?
for us to finance $850,000 ballpark. Obviously, the rates, things change. But last week, or 10 days ago, when I asked Barbara, it's roughly $3,700 a month to finance $850,000 for 30 years. So it's not all that much money.
It is if you're holding the bag after 3 years.
Yeah.
Fine, if you're going to vote to move somewhere else, then we have a building.
Well, we voted that a year and a half ago.
Same thing could be said, though, if we went to the Whately building.
Absolutely.
And SCEMS spent $400,000 or $500,000 to do the build-out, and then 3 years later we're out the door, that money's not going to be recouped, obviously. That's in the building. I guess it's a wash both ways. I think the main focus here, though, is to try to come to some type of compromise, maybe let both scenarios play out and do due diligence on both scenarios and try to move both forward at the same time until one or the other happens.
Well, I mean, it was I thought we agreed on a parallel process.
We agreed that you guys would come back with definitive numbers by tonight. That was our agreement.
And we came back.
No, you haven't. I don't see. I'm sorry, Carolyn. Where is the letter affirming that that Deerfield Academy is going to build this building? Where is the letter affirming that the Board of Trustees and the Deerfield Academy have agreed to give, to provide a gift? Where is any of the concrete evidence that we asked for a month ago and you said we will have it in a month?
That's not true, Mr. Chairman.
That is true.
That's not true. What you asked
Donald
for
Trump,
was
I'm sorry.
Exactly.
My gosh,
what you
it
asked
is
for
true.
Was a definite number. We came back with a number of $36,000 a year. How the town of Deerfield gets that building up,
there's
not
no,
your concern.
There's it's called partnership.
And
partnerships, you are concerned with every element of a process.
I
just like you,
that.
Wait, Kip. Just like over the past year and a half, the town of Deerfield has been concerned with every element, every piece of the process in the conversation to move to the Whately town offices. Every piece of that, the town of Deerfield was concerned about, and they said that is part of our partnership and our cooperation. Suddenly, you can't change. It's not your concern because it's other towns now. You can't have it both ways.
I'm not. You're mixing the words. What I'm saying is that how that building gets built is not Whately's concern. The concern that you and I have as part of this board is that we have a permanent home to go to. How it's accomplished. We could say the same argument as far as what about Whately? You're going to have to go through the same process that we're going through if you choose to do that. We've stepped up. We have a definite guaranteed price for the South County EMS.
It's not definite or guaranteed.
It is.
This
we are saying that we will charge this amount going from July 1, 2017 going forward. How much more definite do you want?
We have no guarantee that the townspeople will agree to it, Kip. That's my struggle. We have none. And except you guys are bringing a special town meeting, which is a lot more easy to manipulate. Not manipulate, that's not fair. It's a lot more easy to pass something at a special town meeting than it is at a regular town meeting. It just is, and you and I both know it. We've been around the block enough times.
Excuse my ignorance when it comes to town meeting law and stuff like that. Regardless of where we go, each town has to vote on it, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So no matter what, this still has to go before a town meeting.
Of each three towns.
Yeah. So regardless if we agreed to go to Whately or agreed to go to Deerfield, other towns could back out.
Unfortunately,
So I think doing the parallel path, you're still going to have a vote no matter what. Before you can agree to go to Whately or before you can agree to go to Deerfield, all three towns still have to approve it.
Regardless of parallel or not, it's just the reality.
Okay.
Right, Chief. No, your statement is true, Chief.
Yeah, Chief, that's right. But the question I have is, when did we get off the dime? The parallel path is supposed to be moving forward. Excuse me, I apologize.
You want to throw it?
I'll catch it. This is the second one that I'm destroying this week, so I don't have
any of my numbers. But the parallel path means that everybody puts a shitload of work into putting town meetings together and votes and everything else. And are we really looking to have this bidding war in three towns, which, with all my history, means failure because basically it's so complicated nobody can understand it. So the simplest thing to do is make a decision, move forward with it, see if the towns are, the three towns people agree with it, and go, because the more parallel path it is, it's going to be 3 years before you even get these people into a home.
Well, we'll have ours. I feel very comfortable. We're going to have ours. Whether or not this board decides to go there, that's something else. But we're going to have this thing there. Now, if we're going to bring this into the whole thing about it, is I might be way off and left base because I've been around a short time here, but South County EMS, which this is a board of, we operate an ambulance service. We don't operate a building construction or any of that kind of thing.
Correct.
So Deerfield has done this work on their own. From my recollection, Whately wants this board to allocate money to the Whately to find out what it's going to cost for to create a plan, bid documents, and things of that sort. And what I suggest is that we don't do that. Let Whately do that if they want to run a parallel thing. Because Whately would love to get money from this board, which in a sense, if they get a price of, say, $20,000 to create plans, Deerfield's got to pay $10,400. Sunderland has to pay $6,400, and Whately's got to pay $3,200.
Kip, I'm going to back up for a second. Because I'm a little nervous about something you just said. And correct me if I'm misunderstanding. You just said that you guys are going to build the building regardless of whether this board votes to move into the building.
Pretty much so.
So.
No, I.
Wait, let me finish. That's what he said.
That is what
my
I
concern
said.
Is that
I
you're
understand.
Saying
I know
that
mean.
The town of Deerfield should. This board vote not to go to a new facility in Deerfield is going to try to run their own ambulance service and will leave SCEMS. No.
I misspoke. What I meant to say is, regardless of how it's funded, the town of Deerfield is committed to do this. I'm sorry.
But
that is not what I said. But that is.
Can I just
say one thing? I would hope the one thing that we'll allow is that we can have conversation going both ways without calling one person Trump and the other person whoever.
And I apologize for that.
I personally, I think having the discussion is a very important part of coming up with a good decision. I also think that all of us here right now, I believe, we're all here for one reason, and that's to continue the good work that South County EMS has done. And I personally have not heard anyone that has challenged the work that we have done. And I would hope that no one's going to be threatening to pull out of South County EMS because of the way of a decision goes one way or the other. I would hope that we come in and take it from last night's debate that we go to it, we make the best decision for all of our shareholders.
Yeah,
and that's all the whole three towns. And I think that's important. That we try to work together and have that discussion. And we can keep going. I just want to throw that out there because I haven't heard anybody sit there dissatisfied with the service yet. Even Larry Risley says it's a good service.
But
Larry, hi.
So Kip, forgive me if I asked you for clarity because you did say the building would exist regardless.
All right, and hopefully I clarified that. I meant we would build the building. We're committed to get the building done, regardless of how it's funded.
If everybody is in, obviously we're not going to build the building if no one's going to it.
And I have to admit, I'm very uncomfortable with the it's not the concern of any other of any of the other two towns, how the building is built. Because if there is a misstep, this building is being built for all on behalf of all three towns. Mm-hmm. We are part of an intermunicipal agreement. So when I'm told, don't worry whether we use prevailing wage, don't worry whether we use public.
I didn't say that either.
But you did, Kip. You said it's not your concern.
You put words into my mouth. You said that we have to use prevailing wage.
And we do.
And did I say, no, sir, we do not?
You said it's not your concern.
So you manipulated into that, we're not going to do it. And if you want to know, there are circumstances where you don't have to pay prevailing wages. If Trevor here has a concrete business and he's the sole proprietor of that concrete business, he can come in there and he can do the work and not pay prevailing
wages. That's true.
So, see, there are, but
there, the building, so if you get the building built pro bono, yeah, you're not gonna. It's another ask for faith.
What we're doing is not going to be any different. Let's ask Waitley, what are you going to do?
We're going to use prevailing wage.
What's the process you're going to use to renovate your building?
We'll go to town meeting.
Same thing Deerfield has to do?
Right. We'll go to a debt exclusion vote.
Same thing Perhaps. We have to do.
Perhaps, though the number isn't as high, so we perhaps could figure out how to do it without going to debt exclusion. Because we all know that debt exclusion, you know, people do a lot of different things in the voting booth than they do on town meeting floor. Understandably, they just do. So I'm not sure we would have to do that. We may not. And that would be a decision that we would have to make. And by the way, we would make it in concert with discussions with you guys. And then we would do our build out, which isn't going to take long at all, obviously.
But what you have to do is no different than what we have to do. But yet you're questioning everything that we want to do.
No, I'm not. I am questioning the. And again, I understand that I wasn't elected to represent the people of Deerfield. But I do worry that we're asking the people of Deerfield to pay X amount of dollars for that process. And asking the people of Waitley to pay X amount of dollars for that process. And Y amount of dollars by one of the two towns will be wasted. It just will, by the process that's being laid out. One of the two towns' funding, or the budget that is spent on the process in one of the two towns, will have gone for nothing other than a backup piece of information. That's it. And I do struggle with that because it means that this service that we all appreciate so much is costing somebody more money than it should. So I do struggle with that. Even Kip, if the decision that was ultimately made after the parallel paths to come to Waitley instead of Deerfield, I would still struggle with the process that we adopted and encouraged for the town of Deerfield to spend money that went for nothing. It just doesn't sit well with me.
So could I, Mr. Chair, so are you saying then the Board of Oversight should look at maybe funding both studies, engineering studies?
The end result is the same. It's just spread out. It's just spread out with Sunderland involved now in terms of taxpayer dollars, unless you wanted to say that the intercept revenue was used for it or for something. But it just, I don't want to be in a competition game, and that's what we created. And I admit I'm part of it.
I'm trying to find common ground. How do you? I mean. And you have a good point. I don't want Waitley, I don't want Deerfield or Sunderland spending money that we don't have. That's why we did the system to begin with, was so that we could afford a system. We're pretty assured by looking at the numbers that there's no way we could do it individually. It'd be very expensive individually to do it. So I don't want Waitley to spend money that they shouldn't have to do, and I don't want to spend Deerfield. And of course, I don't want Sunderland to. So how do we find common ground? And I mean, is there common ground?
Well, if there is a way to go on, Tom, is the fact that on the special town meetings or whatever, they vote to allow SCEMS to go out and get both those projects done, to fund that portion of it so that we can figure out which ones are best for SCEMS to do the work. And then SCEMS money is used to do it, it's fair and equitable, and basically it gets done, and it's done on a timeline collectively together. Mm-hmm. Whaley gives all the stuff they want, and Gearfield gives what they want in the process, and we let the engineers tell us what it's going to cost, or, you know, get to that process and have that money go through SCEMS. We ask the towns to authorize us to spend the money to find a good home for this service, which is doing a great job for us. I don't think anybody would have a hard time with that, because basically we're trying to get the best product for the service to provide, to continue to give good services.
But I don't understand why you think this board should allocate money to either town to renovate.
I'm not saying it is from the town, it should be to get what we need, what this board needs for the...
Well, the board knows what they need, and they created that RFP, and there were two people came back, if I'm not mistaken, mm-hmm. and this board chose to reject both of them right. for certain inadequacies. So what I tried to do is I read the RFP to see what was important, you know, didn't spend a lot of time with that.
Before you continue, let's make one thing clear.
We rejected it.
We rejected it because we were recommended by the town administrators because there was going to be more space available for Waitley's building. So we could then negotiate for more office space because they had cut off more space for their town meeting meetings. Which put us in a shoebox.
They
basically were going to have a big space for town meetings for their town meeting. And jump in anytime, I'm off on this. And the reality was that they decided that to have that much space allocated for two meetings a year, maybe two meetings, didn't make a lot of sense. So they withdrew and they offered it to the school, and the school kind of waffled back and forth, and then at the time when we got the bids, and I speak to this because I was on that board and went through that particular portion of it, we looked at it and we could have accepted Waitley's RFP, but there were some tweaks that the chief and we as a group wanted to make, and that their recommendation so we could make changes was to reject and then negotiate and get what we wanted in Waitley. And then Deerfield decided at that point in time to jump into this race or this process when it's already been going on for a year and a half. So basically it wasn't rejected because it didn't meet their needs, it was rejected because it could have been better.
Doesn't matter, it was rejected, correct?
But it was also rejected at the encouragement of the Deerfield town administrator, who was misinformed that you couldn't negotiate a bid proposal if the bid proposal was accepted. He was absolutely inaccurate in that assessment. In fact, it's easier to negotiate when you accept and then you negotiate rather than you reject them, because of what's transpired here.
The bottom line is that it was rejected, and so we're trying to go forward from there.
So, Mr. Chair, if I could, I'm just looking at numbers, and I'm looking at the Deerfield lease, and I would negotiate a little bit tougher from the board with the Deerfield Board of Selectmen, because there's like escalation costs. I would want to make sure, but that's beside the point. But if you look at pure numbers right now, and I'm using, saying $400,000 the cost to renovate. And I don't know if that's a true number, but that's kind of what we
use. That's the number I've been given.
Okay. So if you look at that, if you look at pure numbers, Deerfield saying $36,000 a year. Okay. So if you look at the $36,000 at the end of 5 years, at the end of 5 years, you have, what, $180,000 worth of rental cost? I think that works out here. It's $180,000. If you look at Whately, if we sign a five-year, I'm saying we signed a five-year lease, Whately's asking, and I'm just saying for past numbers, Whately's saying that they would want the debt paid off in that first lease. That's what they've been saying. So that would mean we'd have to pay off that $400,000 plus the rent, which is $20,000 a month, plus utilities. So I say utilities are equal, so I just put that aside. So that means after, it would basically cost $100,000 a year for the property in Whately. So that's based on the $400,000 divided by 60, which is $6,667 a month. Well, I'm not figuring out the percentage and everything. So that was going to, it would cost us about $80,000 a year to pay that off on our five-year lease. So that means at the end of 5 years, Whately would cost us $500,000 versus $180,000 in Deerfield. Mm-hmm. Step forward 10 years, that I think would be 10 years. So Whately then will drop down to the $20,000 a year, if that's what we're still going to.
Yeah.
So at the end of 10 years, Whately would be looking at $600,000. The cost in Deerfield to us would be $360,000. So we're talking saving significant amount of money.
But after 20 years, carry it out.
After 100 years, who cares? We're not
But 20 years is what is the number that we've all talked about.
I think 20 years is another.
And the reason that Whately talked about 5 years was because we didn't have the capacity to sign an extended IMA, I believe by state law, but there was a restriction there. But this is what negotiation's all about. This is why if SCEMS had come to the town of Whately and entered into negotiation about how does this work going forward, but that never happened because people stopped the process. People created obstacles to the process because people wanted the facility to remain in Deerfield. So the negotiations that had been discussed, again, for the past year and a half, never happened because of obstacles that had been put up. So when Tom talks about numbers, they're somewhat hypothetical numbers because they're not negotiated, they're just what ifs. And it's a fair exercise that he went through, but we never went through the negotiating exercise. And I will argue because of concerns from one of the three towns. Because, and correct me if I'm wrong, because there were enough people in Deerfield that wanted the facility, to remain in Deerfield. So it was delay after delay after delay. And part of it was because people didn't want to go through the exercise of a town meeting vote, whatever the variables were.
But Jonathan, is the point now to talk about what happened in the past, or is it
no? Let's go. But go forward? So we need to figure out how to move forward.
Right. We need to go forward.
And I don't think there's a consensus on this board right now whether to move forward with Deerfield or whether to move forward with Whately. I don't think we have that consensus.
Sounds like another month is going to come before us again.
Well, maybe Tom's idea isn't a bad one. I mean, there's no perfect scenario here. There's just not.
Right. But after 20, did you do the math? After adding the additional 10 years, Deerfield's still cheaper by $70,000 in my head.
You're close.
Well, and honestly, if we get a pure gift, I would say the rental could possibly be negotiated. I mean, this is based on. I know.
What is the
we
basis?
Haven't been able.
What is the
rent? The bus is not my fault.
The 36 is based on the fact that we anticipate, at a minimum, some cash gift, and Kip just picked the 36 out of the. No, you took it off the lease. That was the same.
The other thing is that this money was going to be set aside for future improvements, additions, and stuff.
But
like
I'm not
so 15 years down the road, when something needs to get done, the money is going to be sitting there, because, and I'm only going to speak for Deerfield, Deerfield has been historically horrible about putting money away for whatever reason.
That's all of us.
Having a savings account, I believe, is paramount. I don't care if it's in your own home, or in a town government, or even our federal government. You need to save money, and this is a good way, because it's a very low cost.
And this rent money would go into a separate account, would not go into the general fund. You would vote a separate account. I agree, but I'm just saying, I went to Barbara, and we, I asked her what it would be. What would we be taking on as debt for $850,000? And that.
$37
a month.
A month.
Is a note. At the current rate, obviously, when we go to borrow the money, it, you know, who knows what the rate would be. But at the current rate, 10 days ago, we could, as a town, roughly spend $3,700 a month to carry a note for 30 years. And so, that when Kip said came up with $36,000, that was close. We had an argument.
But that's the carry the note. I mean, you guys are saying two different things though. Kip's saying to set it aside, and you're saying to carry the note.
If we had to finance it, Jonathan. If we had to finance the
entire thing. Right, but earlier Kip said, last meeting Kip said regardless, the rent is based upon operating costs. It's not based upon.
No, not operating costs.
But you specifically said it was not based upon debt.
Correct. It was. So, it could be put aside.
I was saying worst case scenario.
But no scenario. I mean, if that's how it's being sold, that's how it's being sold. There's no alternative scenario.
And again, I think that's something Deerfield has to, that they have to iron it. The one thing I think is that we, as our Board of Oversight, our responsibility is to give all of our residents the best. The bank for their buck at an affordable cost.
Take care of your employees.
Huh?
And take care of your employees.
Yeah, and Zach knows that Zach knows that's been our first priority since day one. But with saying that is that we have to look at. I mean, if you want, you can put out another RFP. I don't know what that would do.
Nothing.
Right. And if. Unfortunately, if Deerfield's coming to us and they say they're going to give us a thing, it's going to cost $36,000 a year, Wendy right now is saying, well, we really don't know how much it's going to cost.
Oh, no, that's not true. Our numbers are as solid as Kip's numbers. That's not true.
Whoa. They just said that the rent is going to stay the same as what they're proposing tonight, period.
And
regardless of what it's funded, and I was... been to multiple meetings in Washington, and that Waitley's rent would be based on a sliding fee scale based on what the renovations are.
No, Waitley's rent would be based on $20,000 on costs that had been itemized out and had been shared with everybody.
Plus the building.
And then the building would be on top of that.
And so that's not set.
The rent is fixed at 20 plus utility. So. There is a difference there.
But the total cost.
The total cost has not been negotiated.
No, we tried.
Okay.
We tried and we were told to walk away. That's my frustration. We tried to enter into negotiation and no one, and this board, prior to four of us sitting on this board, voted for those negotiations to take place. And they didn't take place against the will of the Board of Oversight.
I think the study was clear that showed the location of the service was best to serve Waitley, Sunderland, and Deerfield from that spot. And I think that the town of Deerfield isn't going to be funded if DA doesn't.
The
study showed that the service could be manned be anywhere between Sunderland Station and the Deerfield Station, and any points in between. That's what it said.
Okay, but it was that's within the range,
yeah.
As is the Waitley building.
Yeah,
they're all in the thing.
Go ahead.
So, just to be clear, so is the town of Waitley going to pay for the renovations to the Waitley property,
no.
Or is South County going to be paying for the renovations?
South County would pay.
Because from what I understand from what I think I've heard tonight is that the town of Deerfield has a budget to pay for a building in the town of Deerfield.
No.
They've got an idea to build. They think they might have a proposal for a building in the town of Deerfield. So let's just say that something happens in the distant future. The town of Deerfield will still own a building in the town of Deerfield that the town of Deerfield residents will be paying for. However, South County, if they're going to be paying in to renovate a building in the town of Whately and something happens to the service, where does that money go?
Again, this is what I keep going back to. The SCEMS board encouraged negotiation to discuss those very specifics. And the town of Deerfield kept pushing back and saying, we don't want to negotiate. This is not the direction that we want to take.
Because I'm just thinking of it like a rental.
It's true. A year and a half ago, Carolyn, it was decided by this board to go to Deerfield.
I thought it was in the June minutes that the RFP was rejected.
No. Long before the RFP went out. And the RFP was submitted as a way, or was put out there as a way to try to figure out how to pull Deerfield into the process so that they understood. A year and a half ago.
Bruce, I don't believe that is true. I think the RFP was established because they wanted to be fair and competitive. Everybody would have a chance. The town of Sunderland brought the RFP to the SCEMS meeting, said this is an RFP that's worked in other communities. The town of Deerfield took it, revised it, and put it out to bid without the review of the Board of Oversight.
And
that's what happened.
That's correct. But it got to that point because nothing had moved in terms of discussions based upon a vote of this board. It's just accurate.
I think to go back and read the minutes, that was not the intent. The intent was to make sure everybody had a chance.
And everyone did have a chance.
To make an offer.
And the proposal that Kip is suggesting wasn't one of those options.
Understood.
It just wasn't.
Nobody said it was.
But I guess my point right now, does it matter?
It doesn't matter, it's just like the ambulance thing. It's like, we know that there might be grant money, even though we've made the commitment to go ahead and buy this thing, but there's still a chance, I don't know what it is, to apply for this grant. You know, whenever you can get something that could be a better situation, why not go for it? And so, like I said several meetings ago, for whatever reason, it didn't happen. So here we are today. Let's go forward and get this place going.
And minutes, okay. But I just, there are minutes, documented minutes, that talked about how the reason it didn't move forward was because people, a segment of the population in Deerfield said, we want the facility in Deerfield. No ifs, ands, or buts. In fact, there were conversations. Yes, Carolyn, there were conversations.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is we're giving the people an opportunity to back up their words. And that's why we're going forward. That's why Kip has put in all this effort.
So our elected officials listened to the residents and brought forth another option.
To some of them. There was no referendum.
We'll find out next month.
I'm done. Do what you want.
No. I think we're going to have more information by next week. I said that.
We're kicking a can down the road.
The trustees of Deerfield are meeting the Halloween weekend. And based on the information that comes out of that trustees meeting, we will have a game plan for meeting with the Capital Improvement Committee on Wednesday, November 2nd. Hopefully, we can post a finance committee meeting that same week. And Kip will be ready to move forward, hopefully, with his estimates or whatever.
I'm ready to go now. I mean, and that's why the commitment that we're making is regardless.
And then we have to have that week of the 9th, probably our November 9th selectmen's meeting will be an informational night as to what action we're taking. And then the town meeting will vote November 14th to support that option. It's a fairly tight timeline that we're committed to.
So if you're saying that, then the reality is this has to go on to the registry 3 weeks before we have a special town meeting, right?
Only if we're building it.
But you're asking the townspeople for money. You can't do it from the 9th to the... You can't do it short notice. You got to tell them what you're doing well before it comes to a special town meeting.
We're not asking for money at this special town meeting.
Yeah, we're not, we're just asking for the to move forward.
To move forward with what?
With whatever option comes out of that first week of November.
Accept either the gift or to fund it.
No, we're not going to ask them to fund that time. What the biggest reason for the special town meeting was to change the way the land was accepted. Instead of it's now for the highway garage, so we're going to change that to any uses.
So realistically, you'll have to have another special town meeting to do anything else.
Or it could be
a special or go to the town meeting. Yeah.
Yeah, June, July, August. It would be tight to wait until April.
Well, April, no, you're not going to have the building. You'll have to have another one if you're not asking for money. I'm not supporting anything
at this point.
I'm glad you guys are having this conversation. That's great.
It's just not adding up. That's my concern. That's the timeline that Mark just brought up was something that I tried to get forth too long ago tonight. The timeline just is. You're not asking for money in November. You're going to have to ask for money at some point, and then you got to go to debt exclusion.
Mm-hmm. We understand that. But there's things that have to happen, and that's why we're starting in November. We're starting the wheels turning. We don't know at this point how it's going to be funded. It might not even have to go to town meeting. But we don't know that right now. What we're saying to this board and trying to get some steady, conclusion is the town of Deerfield wants to do this. How we fund this, we're not sure, but it's going to happen for us. Now, and that's why we wanted this board's blessings to go forward with what we do. I was a bit adamant about the whole idea of what the purpose of this board is. And, it's not to generate money to give to any community to do this research. And I would say to you, I know I've said it 4 or 5 times, but once again, if Whately wants to do, to renovate their building for housing for South County EMS, they should do the same thing that we're doing.
So you're willing to waste somebody's money, be it the town of Deerfield's money or the town of Whately?
You know what, Jonathan, that's up to you.
No, I'm asking you a question. You're okay with that?
I don't feel it's a waste of money. I don't feel it's a waste of time and effort on my part. I don't think it's a waste of Deerfield taxpayers' money. If you think your proposal is so strong, then you should talk to your residents and move forward as well.
We've talked to them so many times, and you know that.
Then that's what you're faced with,
So, but again, you're saying that if this board ultimately decided to go to Whately, after you had spent the money, let's again say the Deerfield Academy is not going to make their gift, and you have to create bid-ready documents to the cost of $800,000 building.
$8,000.
$80,000.
$8,000 to $12,000. Yeah.
No,
10%.
10%.
15%.
$80,000 to $100,000. You're willing to say that's money well spent if this board ultimately decided to go to Whately? Really?
I don't know where you come up with your numbers, but I don't know.
What numbers didn't make sense then?
You're saying $80,000 to $100,000 for bid ready documents? Are you kidding me?
What architect do you use?
It's going to be a canned building.
That's not the design that we saw. It's not a canned building.
It's a canned building. You go to a registered.
Trevor is not a carpenter, but that building, Trevor and I could frame in about a week. This is not a big elaborate job. It doesn't get any simpler than this. You pour a concrete wall 4 feet high, and you stand up 2x6s, and you put it. It's just.
That's my concern. It's everything's so simple.
Oh my lord.
No.
I'll give you just another example. I have a building. I mean, I'm trying to ease your concerns about this. And I mean, I put up a building on my property that everybody might have known as Dr. Spooky's. I had a broken collarbone, and my son had another broken collarbone. And it took us 3 weeks to frame the building. This is not a complicated thing. It's so simple. It will go together so fast. It, you know, just doing the paperwork for it is what's the complicated part.
Getting it through this meeting is actually.
Yeah.
But my feeling is, again, like I said last meeting, what it say we get a say we get a gift. Does it? Does this board feel like it is beneficial to our town, to our residents, to our employees, to move forward in this direction, or is this a complete waste of time? I mean, he's put in a ton of work to try and get this thing off the ground. I know Waitley's put a ton of work in. We as a board have to decide which one of these looks good and start moving forward on it. I wish we had an answer right now. I mean, it's the frustrating thing to wait on other people. It's just life. I mean, because our meetings are scheduled at a certain date, I can't force these people to make a decision. We think we have a good plan going forward, but we just don't, you know, we'll know soon. And we said that twice before, and how frustrating is that? And you've been waiting 2 years to get this thing going, or a year and a half. I feel your pain. I think it is a great option if it does work out, and that's, you know, I think we should go forward in that direction. If we get the gift, even if the town puts it forward, it seems like it's more economical, but.
Stay tuned, there'll be more information next week.
He's been right all night.
Within the IMA, does this then have to go to all three towns to vote on the location to move it?
Yes. Unless it stays in Deerfield.
Yes.
No, it does. It's still a possibility.
You still have to. Okay.
And the other aspect of it.
Across the parking lot?
Yep.
Yeah,
So it has to go to all three towns.
We're moving all three vehicles into one location.
So that being said.
Well, that's one interpretation.
Okay. Well, we were hoping that we'd clean up the language.
I think if you really read it legally, I think the Board of Selectmen can make the choice.
I thought that too.
Well, you need to. The Board of Selectmen can vote to change the IMA.
Right, but we
can't. Yes, it's
you can change the bizarre. IMA, but
you can change anything in the IMA, which would mean you could then change. You would not need town meeting vote. But it.
Yeah, that's pretty. And that's the way it's read. Right?
Yeah, don't get me going on.
We tried really hard to get that changed in Deerfield, and our portions of it, so the language was cleaned up and made more simple to have this board to be able to make those types of decisions.
Yeah, I remember seeing those.
And that got swapped. So that would be something I'd recommend that you guys get back on track so that basically this board can continue.
As soon as we find the housing, we'll go and do our needed business. But well, the housing has to be accomplished. And it has to be accomplished.
Tom, I wholeheartedly agree with you.
I
and I'm not looking to cause problems.
But
all right,
I could just 1 second. I said what I said, but I have the Board of Selectmen and the Board of Oversight have consistently said that would go back to town meeting for to maintain compliance. So I would take it back to. I would recommend that each town go back to town meeting
and get it corrected.
Because that's what we said, and we do. And we want to be true to the word. We can change it later, but right now it needs to go.
All right, so just from a process standpoint, so that has to happen first. So I'm going to play the what if. And please don't take this the wrong way. Deerfield's got to pay a portion of this. We don't get the gift to cover the whole thing. Mm-hmm. You go to the meeting, we get initial approval. Now you got to go back for money to get it. Is there a way that you can ask the townspeople for the money without definitely knowing that all three towns are going to support the move to that building versus the move to the Waitley?
Yeah,
it just worked the article.
Both towns. And I only ask that because if there's something that needs to happen ahead of time in the IMA, you should get going on that now to help make that later on. But
I think
if it's
biggest,
not a worry.
Matt, to me the biggest thing is, I'll agree with Jonathan. I agree with a lot that he says, okay? Mm-hmm. But on the process right now, And what Kip and Jonathan say, if you stand back, they're saying the same things. But right now, if you're on the Board of Oversight like we are, and we're not selecting for appropriate town, basically we do not really have a proposal in front of us. Not a true proposal. Because in Deerfield has a value, but they're not sure that it can be built yet. They haven't received town meeting approval. So we don't really have Whately, we have a proposal, but we don't have numbers. So we do have two potential, but we don't have a singular from each one would give us hard numbers.
Well, again, I've said it before, if someone ever negotiated with us, they'd have hard numbers, but no one's willing to negotiate with us.
Well, be a double advocate, so don't yell at me, but as double advocate, if you're saying, if Whately's saying that we as the Board of Oversight need to fund the...
I'm not saying that. I'm saying negotiate.
Okay, fine. We'll negotiate.
I
can't we have a problem if we negotiate with them?
No. That's what we said the town administrators were going to do last month.
Right. They were going to negotiate the work down the negotiations of what it would take in Whately. Well, and Deerfield was going to come back with their...
Well, but see, Mark, I genuinely think that the negotiation should not be between the three towns. The negotiation should be with this board, because this board is the one with the fiduciary responsibility and okay. The oversight responsibility. What's that?
Fine.
I just think
then we can negotiate. We're still going to have to go through the town of Deerfield.
Well, I understand that, but again,
I don't care if we negotiate. I don't care if we send two members or three members from this board to negotiate. Fine.
Because then the town of Deerfield has something to respond to.
What's that?
If somebody from SCEMS negotiated, and you're right, you have to go back.
Right now, Deerfield doesn't need to negotiate with anybody because they're putting a proposal separate. What they are right now is they are the TKC Corporation. Trevor, Kip, Carolyn Corporation. That's all I know. That they're bringing forward a proposal. You're bringing forward a proposal. You're not Whately to me. You're whatever your initials are. Why does it have to be a town? I don't care how they go through town meeting. I don't care how you go to town meeting. Why should I care?
Again, the rules are changing.
No, they're not changing.
Yeah, they are. But that's okay. That's really okay.
So if you wanted to go, do you want to set a negotiating team?
That's what I suggested a while back. But
Mr. Chair, want to set a negotiating team? We want one from each. What's that?
Why wouldn't the whole board do that?
We can do that also.
I would argue that, well, okay.
One from every town.
Who wants to be? Who wants to negotiate?
Tom.
Thanks.
You're a good poker player.
I'll do it. There you go.
All right. Who's that? Who else?
Jonathan. You.
Who's going to negotiate from here for Whately, and who's going to, and we're going to talk to Whately?
Gary.
You want to be Whately?
No, I think Gary should be with him.
Sure.
I think it should be a selectman.
What's that?
I think it should be a selectman.
Okay.
All right.
Does that, and I don't know, being a selectman, are you negotiating with the Board of Selectmen and Whately?
I know, that's the...
Well, and so I
who's your chair?
What's that?
Are you the chair in Whately?
Yeah. No. I missed who from Deerfield would be.
Kip.
Right, I mean, it's... And part of my struggle with this, and again, I get that I'm saying that this should be negotiated, but clearly we have a conflict of interest with Whately and with Deerfield. And so you have two of the three towns on this negotiating committee with conflicts of interest.
No, they're not.
Oh, they kind of.
No. You got to understand. We better put our selectmen's hat out the door when we're negotiating. And if you can't put your selectman's hat outside the door...
I'm not sure that's happening in any of these meetings, Tom.
How can you say that?
I'll tell you what, I said I would resign and put Matt Russo back on. Because, in my opinion...
And I told him I was going to resign first, and I had to say that.
Matt Russo, in my opinion, Matt Russo represents the what we need here.
I couldn't agree more.
So I'm not thinking of it as Sunderland Selectmen. I'm thinking of it what's best for the South County EMS. That's why Bobby's here. I know that's why Gary's here, because I've been here for a while.
I joined this board because I was asked to join the board. I am with you. We didn't, for the longest time, Whately didn't have a select board member on this board because we thought that it should be members who know how to run an ambulance.
Right.
And this building disaster is why there was pressure to have a select board member on it. The building issue is the only reason
that we have a select board member. It shouldn't be an issue.
Well, if you three people can't do it by next month, then maybe the three town administrators. They have no.
Let them do it.
Deerfield doesn't have a town administrator right now.
No. But I mean,
sorry.
I don't know. To me, it's kind of like, you know, nothing against the town administrators. They're town administrators. They don't understand the building, the construction, the operations, and stuff like that. I mean, you know, other thing, and I didn't even get to the part, this is right up Jonathan's wheelhouse with his work. I mean, I don't 100% sure, but I just happened to notice the heaters in the garage in Whately, for a prime example. I think that there were three of them. Each of those was 175,000 BTUs. The building that we're going to do is have two furnaces, and each one's going to be 85,000 BTUs. The operation cost of this building will be at least a fifth of what it would be in Whately.
And you don't think that's a conflict of interest at some level to be on a negotiating team? He already said that it's not as good. That's my struggle with this.
But I'm just pointing out, I'm bringing it forward, I'm making it open to everybody, you know. So going down the road, you know, if you're in one location and you get a gas bill, and the gas bill is $300 a month versus $1,200 a month, you know, I mean, I saw that in our own highway garage. Our electric bill went from what, $300 to $1,800?
Well,
because
there's actually lights on.
The bottom line is it's kind of the operational part of it too, you know. And I just want everybody to be informed.
I don't know why.
What if the three towns paid for the build out in that building? I mean, your field share of that would be their share of 400,000 would be a whole lot less than 800,000.
They just did the math.
Three towns paid
10
for
years
the build out.
In 10 years, it's still savings.
Yeah. Well, this
20 years,
we still save this as money as we want to make it.
I'll tell you right now.
And the thing about it is, the town of Deerfield's going to incur a lot more costs than what is on paper for this build out, because we still have to pay the debt for building the building if Deerfield Academy doesn't. So there are numbers that are not there that are not going to be given to, or need to be given to the townspeople when they make those decisions. Right now, we're just arguing about semantics of it. I think that I put the proposals together and let that be what they are.
Just one sentence.
Yeah.
One thing for sure, we're going to have another meeting next month, and maybe we'll find out something.
Right again.
That's exactly why I approached this way, because I didn't want this to go on. I wanted this to be. This is something that this board can look at and say, okay, board, no, here we have an opportunity to go to a place that is going to be pretty close to what we need, and it's $36,000 a year. We don't have to worry about what the cost is. We don't have that. This is what's in front of the board. This
you
is
have to worry about it happening, Kip. You can't guarantee it.
Can you guarantee it's going to happen? Wait, you better do the same thing we have to do. That's what I'm, you get frustrated, I do too. We're going to do the exact same thing in two different locations. So as much as you're saying, how do you know what's going to happen, Kip? I say, how do you know what's going to happen, John? You know, we have to put it in front of our people.
Okay, we've had a lot of town meetings on this for discussion. I mean, you know, Kip, Whately's been talking about this for a long time in conjunction with the board. But, you know, Chip was right when he walked out. This is going around in circles, and this is just as ridiculous.
But right now, Whately has nothing to lose.
Bruce, just one quick comment.
You don't have anything to lose.
I'm wondering whether or not Deerfield Academy needs something from the Board of Oversight.
No.
They don't. So it's the Board of Oversight doesn't need to vote on it at all. Doesn't need to say we support Oversight's just renting a building.
The board of Oversight is just renting space, and that, in my opinion, I think that's what we need to do.
It's critical that we get everybody under one roof.
Understand, but I was just wondering, it sounded like there was some need for this $36,000 agreement to at least have some agreement up on by booth that it's acceptable, so you can move forward to the next step. And the next step would be have the trustees either give you money, give you a building, or not do anything.
That's part of the proposal. We, you know, Kip and others have worked diligently to get with Deerfield County to see if they can make this thing happen.
Well, I think it might help the Deerfield residents because it's on the special town meeting warrant that we're going to be asked to agree to a rental agreement with the Board of Oversight for a dollar amount. If we don't have the recommendation, that at least some indication that the Board of Oversight supports this, I think it's going to fail at the town special town meeting.
I would hope. People have been asking Deerfield Academy for a while. So, I mean, Kip has done a lot of work. John Pachort started the conversation probably two or three years ago. So, right?
John Pachort and I were in this conversation over 3 years ago.
Yeah, so we feel pretty comfortable that we're going to get, I mean, that the town of Deerfield would not be financing the entire building by itself. And I think logistically, when we get done, the SCEMS would look at the numbers and say, well, why would we move there? We're moving across the parking lot into a building that we're under one roof, and it'll be very inexpensive.
I agree in concept. The issue is we're holding a special town meeting where you have a low turnout. And the people that want to vote this in will. And the people that don't have any idea what's going on with this short-term turnaround time.
The majority of people don't know.
I think if we take out the ambulance service and just view the ambulance service as a tenant, for starters. So we have the town of Deerfield that is proposing a building, which is going to be roughly the needs of the tenant. And then we have the town of Waitley, which has a pre-existing building but needs to be renovated to meet the needs of said tenant. Now, we have an idea what the cost might be for the town of Deerfield. We don't have a cost for the town of Waitley.
About $400,000.
Roughly. So.
No, not roughly. There is.
Okay, so $400,000.
They're as good as Kip's numbers.
Okay, so $400,000. Okay, so you have Waitley with $400,000. So that building is owned by the town of Waitley. Now, if I am a landlord, I shouldn't make my tenants renovate my property. So.
No, that's common in business.
Right. So if
it's
you.
Very common. That the tenants pay for renovations.
That the tenants pay for renovations. So if I rented, say, a house and the roof leaked, my tenant would pay for a new roof?
No, if you had a business and you wanted to.
You're talking commercial versus private.
Make it from one.
Or residential.
Business to another business, that's your problem. You're renting the space and you want to turn it into a restaurant. Your landlord's not going to make it into a restaurant.
Waitley had offered initially, correct me if I'm wrong, to waive the rent during the construction period.
And that's still on the table.
And the rent would begin when occupancy began, assuming occupancy begins at the completion of construction.
And it's still given a common place for it to exist.
Well, once again, you're asking a tenant to do leasehold improvements. And to his comments, you know, if you're going into any commercial building, you can go to this commercial building where you have to make extensive leasehold improvements, or you can go over here where it's ready to move in. It costs you nothing. To me, it's a no-brainer.
But it doesn't cost nothing because it's costing $36,000 a year.
This one over here to these renovations.
Okay, but you can compare, but don't say it's not costing anything. That's my only point.
The rent.
It's not costing anything.
The rent is $2,000 over here. It's $3,000 over here.
over here, you've got $400,000 in leasehold improvements. Over here, you have no movement cost. It's quite simple when you make it that, you break it down like that.
All right, let's move on. I don't think we got any other change in ideas that we haven't already exchanged. Anything else to come before the Board of Oversight?
If I could make point.
Anything new?
No, well, there was a comment made earlier. I know it was concerned about the budget. You made the comment that some people feel that the cost of this service is too high.
Could be.
Well, could be too high.
Right. I didn't say it was definite, and I did not, so be careful there. I just said that I'm trying to go back, but
I think you guys should be cautious.
Right. Everybody wants to be cautious about bottom line here as far as being able to hold a reasonable cost. And as I said before, and I don't know if you heard this, Matt, or not, but nobody has said anything about the service. In fact, there's nothing but kudos about the service as far as the response time, so on and so forth. That's not the issue whatsoever. Item that I brought up was the potential growth that we had been hearing about in the bottom line costs. And that's where people were a little concerned as far as trying to make sure it was cost effective, because we've accomplished, I think anyways, for the most part, except for the housing issue here, that we've pretty much, this oversight board and the people involved with this, have accomplished what was presented to all three towns as far as what their goals were, what they're trying to establish, and we've done that. And or at least I think we're at that point, pretty darn close to it, besides the housing issue. And I think you'll find that everybody, or most people, are very happy with that. But at the same time, there is that budget concern that, you know, some people want to make sure that we stay cost effective. And that's where the growth issue came in, where if that's going to start climbing that bottom line up, there's going to be some concerns. You know, if it's not going to be able to be offset. You know, if you grow and you can lower that bottom line, great. You know, I don't think anybody would argue that. But if you're going to try to grow and that bottom line continues to increase, I think there's going to be some concern. Yeah. So I don't want to be misunderstood.
I appreciate the clarification, because right. I know when I served on this board, I was accused by finance committee members that we had no clue what we were doing financially. Because
please use the term some.
Some.
Okay.
Some. Because we had all this money left over, and we had blown up budgets and exaggerated figures. It was only because of the fiscal responsibility and the conservative nature of this board that we delivered that service at the cost that we did. Furthermore, if you look at what this service cost just the town of Deerfield, it cost about a third of what our police service costs us. And this is not a knock against the police. I'm a tremendous supporter of the work that our police have done. I think they do a phenomenal job. Mm-hmm. But when you look at pure numbers, and Zach mentioned it earlier, it's a service that runs at a staffing level comparable to what our police department is for a third of the cost. If you look at the service that it provides compared to the South Deerfield Fire District, and again, I know I'm comparing fire and police to EMS, but again, it is a full-time, 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week service that produces at a cost that is less than what the total budget of the fire department is.
Well, you know, we can get into that, Matt, and I think that's an issue for the town of Deerfield. And I don't want to reflect on the board, because I think the board's doing a pretty good job. But at the same time, when you're talking about carrying over $500,000 in supposedly called free cash, that does raise some eyebrows. The police department doesn't carry $500,000 over in free cash. Yeah. So like I say, we can get into that another time. I think that's something that the town of Deerfield, I don't want to take up time here. That's not what the board.
How long has that police department been in operation?
Well, I say semantics, and I'm not going to argue that at this point.
This was a new startup.
No, I understand.
It's only had 2 years of budget history.
I understand that, but you only started.
We could spend the whole another night.
Exactly, that's what I'm trying to avoid.
One thing that they should, and Matt, what you're saying is that it is, but what this service does do is it has an income, which the police doesn't. And if you take away their income, they're not that far apart.
Correct.
Yeah, I mean, you let the police go, and you know, they could support themselves really easy.
No, that's okay.
I understand, but I just want to make that clarification, because we've been accused of over-budgeting and inflating, and we built this. The goal was to deliver at a price where we wouldn't have to go back and ask for any more money.
Right. And I get that, and it has worked, and there's no complaints about that. But you know, in fairness, when you say stuff like that, you really should say that, you know, we do charge money, and that's why we have this. Mm-hmm. You know, and I mean, it was great, and to my point where I was saying we want to save money for the future, it's great that when we're buying this ambulance, the money was there.
Right.
You don't have to go to the police, you know, the money is there, you know, and that's okay.
Well, and to the same point, had we not lowered our rates last year and kept them the same, and kept some of that money, we'd have it to apply towards this building project. We wouldn't have to.
But I don't think that's a good, I don't think that's, I don't believe this is the job of this board.
So, can I, Mr. Chair, can I just ask one question about the budget?
Go ahead.
All right, and I hate to bring up spilled milk, but a couple of years ago, the towns of Whately and Sunderland were crucified in the town of Deerfield select board meeting because we hadn't paid anything to the town for our service, okay? I'm just asking. That wasn't because we didn't want to pay, but no one sent us a bill. So I'm just asking, when I went over, I looked at the latest figures, I don't think anybody sent us a bill yet for our services. Yeah. Do you have an idea when financial, are you planning on billing us quarterly or?
No, it's quarterly.
Is that what you're doing? Okay.
I'm pretty sure it's quarterly.
All right.
Because
you don't want that. You don't want to ask me a question.
Quarterly,
right?
Quarterly, 8 times a year.
Okay.
I'm pretty well. No, Barbara.
And that's fine. Can you just ask?
Yes.
And if we have an answer for, and again, I just don't want to get accused of not paying the bill.
I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Absolutely. You know what I'm saying?
All in favor?
Aye.
I'm saying I want to keep going.
Stop.